So I don't get this chance often enough to introduce my esteemed senior colleague, Professor Jerome Nriagu. As you heard, he's from the School of Public Health at the University of Michigan, where he has researched three main topics: sources, behavior, fate, and effects of metals in the natural and contaminated environments, environmental justice and disproportionate exposure of communities to environmental pollutants, and environmental health problems in developing countries. And it's that third aspect that our work coincided, and I began to learn a lot more about his contributions to the literature and activism in environmental health, and is an inspiration for many of the people in my generation who are working on this topic. He's one of the most highly cited scientists in the fields of environmental studies and in ecology. That's according to the ISI highlycited.com. I didn't know they have that, actually. And he's been the director of the Environmental Health Program at Michigan since 1996. And he's also a member of the Royal Society of Canada, and has received so many awards for his work. Editing the journal Science of the Total Environment, and most recently came out this year with a 10-volume series of Encyclopedia of Environmental Health. And for this and many other activities that he engages in, we're really glad he made the time to come to talk to us today. So please join me to welcome Dr. Nriagu.
Thank you very much, Dele, and then thank all of you for coming to listen to me. And I'd like to thank the organizers of the conference for actually paying my airfare. That was very important. So I'm going to challenge you, okay? I'm not really going to be giving you a canned lecture, which I normally give, so I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to make some provocative statements, and I hope eventually by the time you leave the talk, you learn something or you got something from the talk that will get you to think, I never thought of that before, right? So hopefully I hope that will happen. So the first question, I'll start with a question. If you live near a dump site or an incinerator, are you a victim of environmental justice? Think about that. If next day, tomorrow, somebody wants to put a giant, big incinerator in your backyard, will you become, or are you then, a victim of environmental justice? If you can't answer the question by the end of the talk, you should come to me and get a refund for your for the course. Okay. There are four principles that currently guide the environmental health policies. There are four principles. One is the precautionary principle. It's taboo with EPA and in this country, but in Europe, it's widely used. The precautionary principle. You have the environmental justice principle. You have the environmental sustainability principle. I'm not even going to touch that. You can all lecture me on that one. And then you have the polluter pays principle. EJ is the one that includes the elements of ethics and rights. You tend to basically state that environmental justice generally assumes that every person has a right to a clean environment. Unfortunately, we can never get that into the law of this land or anywhere. So again, even if that's the underlying assumption of environmental justice, that everybody is entitled to, or has a right to a clean and a healthy environment. We have a fifth principle that has recently been put forward by peer of all people, Newt Gingrich, the fifth principle. So why don't you simply have a compact with the earth, right? So instead of having the normal management policies, we just work out some type of a compact with the earth. And well, I don't know why they sent me a copy of the book. So I read it, and from there I have tried to figure out what agenda are they proposing in the book, right? And I'm not kidding you. These are some of the things they are proposing. They want to ask for more research, obviously. They want to ask for more money, more reviews. You never get enough reviews. You can always write another review on the topic. They actually want to make the thing so complicated, nobody understands the issue. They want to control the communications, obviously. They set the wrong targets. They set all these straw persons to be in charge. And then, of course, they attack the integrity of the scientists. What this basically boils down to is this. Leave it up to the industries, and they'll do the right thing. That's the fifth principle. We know that doesn't always happen, and I'm not going to go into that. But again, this is a fifth principle that is being advocated by some politicians like Newt Gingrich. Okay, so let me give you some indisputable facts then about environmental justice. Three facts that almost everybody agrees to now. One is that there are more environmental hazards in disadvantaged communities. Daniel mentioned, they gave you a few examples. This is almost everybody agrees to that. The next fact is that there are more individuals with poor health in disadvantaged communities. Again, everybody agrees to that. And the third fact is that individuals with poor health tend to be more susceptible to environmental pollutants. Again, most people agree to that. So these are the three facts that most people in the environmental justice field all agree to. We have more pollutants, or at least more polluting industries in these communities, disadvantaged communities. You have people with poorer health in these communities, as well as people who have poorer health tend to be more susceptible to environmental pollutants. And then that's where I have a problem with some of the what you see in the literature. Therefore, right, we all agree on this. Therefore, the question then is, there must be a cause-effect relationship between living in one of these areas with high concentration of hazards and the health of the people, right? All I'm going to tell you, most of my work actually, well, it's not most of my work. What I'm going to talk to you this morning, or the message I'm trying to present you this morning, is that the science cannot and does not allow us to make that connection. The causal link between living, or what we are seeing here, what we agree to, people in our disadvantaged communities having poorer health, and therefore attributing the health or some of the health effects to being near these pollutants. Some of it may sound heretical, but we'll see. Well, I try to develop that theme, and I try to explain to you why I think so. Okay, so to begin explaining the difference, this disconnect, I want to start with the issue of a hazard, right? What is a hazard? A hazard has the potential to cause harm or result in a negative health consequence. is the potential. And so, when you go to these communities, you see a lot of hazards, right? That's what you see, a lot of hazards. So here's an example. Here's an example then of one of these degraded dump sites. You see a lot of them in some of these poor communities. Or else, you know, the military have been dumping, leaving behind a lot of these toxic material in Alaska. And here then is one of the natives talking about some of these contaminants. Again, we're talking about hazards, the potential, not the effect. And then this is another dump site in Alaska. These are all hazards, right? On the other hand, let's look at this picture. You see a difference. Here now we are dealing with hazards and risks. So the industry itself represents the hazard, right? The risk comes from the smoke. The risk then is the likelihood or the probability that you are going to be exposed to some type of a toxic material. Okay, so again, when we talk about having all these dump sites, these are hazards. Question is, how many of the people who actually live near these things get exposed to the hazard? Something we need to think about again when you see some of the reports. Okay, so then, this case we are talking about hazards and risks. So here's your risk, emissions, and then the hazard is this waste sitting somewhere. Okay, another example, Chicago, the Chicago toxic donut. Again, you have your smoke representing your risk or creating the risk for the community. And then you have the hazard, which means all the waste that have been sitting there for a while. It doesn't mean that the hazards cannot pose a risk, but we cannot equate hazards with risks, right? A lot of people tend to equate hazard with risk. That's not true. Again, I hope this is something we can, if you can just remember that, it's very important. Okay, so then here is an example where they're talking about the enrichment, trying to stop the enrichment of a plant in Houma, Louisiana. And look at what they're actually protesting against. Instead of protesting against the risk, they are protesting against the hazard, the trash. They have their minds in the right direction, but I think they are really talking about the wrong thing. The most likely thing then will be the enrichment will release all types of radionuclides in addition to any thrash. See? Okay. So then, let's then step back and follow the development of the progress with the environmental justice movement. So again, if you look at segregation areas in the US, you can see extreme segregation with more than 60 to 80% segregation. Detroit, of course, is somewhere here. So again, you see there are many places with very extreme or very significant separation between the various races. And then if you relate the cancer risks to these segregation index, you see that in general, the most segregated areas, extreme segregated areas, have the highest cancer risk, calculated cancer risk. Whereas areas with low segregation in general have low cancer risk. Again, this obviously is very important in terms of how, okay. This is, okay. One more time. Okay, again, this is obviously very, very important because here we are talking about the risk. So somehow they've managed to translate the segregation into some type of where people live, and therefore the estimated risk. We'll go through it very quickly then. And then the also people have looked at the population of the people living in counties with non-attainment air pollution levels of 65 microgram per cubic meter. Again, if you look at that, you find that in general, the islanders tend to live in counties with the highest concentrations of particulate matter in the air. The blacks, obviously, and then where's the total, general U.S. total. So again, they find differences on a countrywide basis. But in general, some people tend to live in areas with much higher ambient air pollution levels. Again, these are reported stuff. And then we, if you think of places in the country where you have these major problems, so if you look at the locations of the environmental justice groups in the country, find that they mushroom and become very, 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 many of them. And what do they do? Usually, most of them tend to form to address either a regional or local issue. So what that basically then says is that whatever happens, there's a problem, and that problem is getting a lot of attention in the country. And they're actually getting money in many cases also to work on this problem. So we've already talked about what is environmental justice, right? And that is defined by Bullard, is the right, is the principle that all people and communities are entitled to equal protection of environmental and public health laws and regulations. So this has already been defined previously. I step back and look at it as a scientist. So how can we then actually prove or show that indeed this principle is being met, right? How can we, this is a scientific issue now, scientific question. Environmental regulations, they are the best normally scientific issues. So how can we use science to prove or document or make sure that these principles are being met? Well, before we do, I'm sure you all remember the President Clinton signing the executive order. So the question then is, let's assume you are or you think you're a victim of environmental justice. What remedies do you have under the law in this country, for instance? So now we have this principle of environmental justice, and then you suddenly realize that you're a victim of environmental injustice. So what remedy do you have under the law in this country? Anybody know what, if you want to sue somebody, what article of the Constitution would you use to sue somebody for the environmental injustice that you are being exposed to? Answer is that we actually have absolutely no protection under the law. You can sue the person for nuisance, right? That's all you have, for nuisance. Well, if you are the person, if you are the operator or the owner of the incinerator and somebody is suing you for a nuisance, $100 a day. So keep doing what you are doing. It's not really not important. See, it's only $100. So then, the only right of what people are trying to do, why don't we use the Civil Rights Act? And that's why this expansion of the definition becomes important. Instead of just focusing on equal protection of environmental regulations and so on, then we expand it to include all these other factors, economic, social. Unfortunately, the law courts are not accepting it. So again, in most cases, going to taking your case to the court will obviously question is what article of the law is the person breaking? And as we said, we don't really have any laws that protect people. We don't have any rights in the Constitution that guarantees access to clean air or clean water. The only thing actually we have then is more or less this executive order by Clinton, and is, if anything, is just use persuasion and negative publicity. Executive order allows you to simply use negative publicity and persuasion to see if they can actually do something for you. So then, as a scientist then, it means that the cornerstone of environmental justice rests on the premise that the environmental risks are higher for poor people and minorities. It therefore fits naturally into the risk assessment paradigm, a logical way to study environmental justice is, in fact, to use the risk assessment paradigm. We can then use the risk decision process after that. So what's the principle? The principles of risk assessment is to identify and evaluate populations and subpopulations, individuals that are at the highest comparative risk that may need to be targeted for remedial intervention or action. And how do we identify these people at risk? They are at higher risk when they are exposed above a certain health-related benchmark or threshold, or we know they are more susceptible to environmental exposures. And therefore, EJ, environmental justice, then can be all these environmental justice programs, activities, and so on, are supported to some extent by either qualitative or quantitative risk assessment. So again, this is a scientific approach to environmental justice, or risk-based approach to environmental justice. Indeed, in most cases, most of my work is actually focus on developing a robust quantitative risk assessment method that can be used or applied to prove disproportionate exposure or therefore document or demonstrate environmental justice. We'll see what people have been doing before. So, what do communities, this is what the scientists want to do, exposures and health effects. Whereas the communities have a different idea on what kind of study they need. These communities that experience environmental justice have different ideas of what studies they need. They believe or they expect environmental justice, people in environmental justice science, to address or determine the social relations that create the racial and economic disparities in the first instance. They want this environmental justice science to evaluate the environmental conditions that lead to these negative health outcomes and then how to remove these disparities. And they want the environmental justice science to actually identify the causes of these determinants of health. As you can see, this is a tall order for scientists. We are not used to dealing with some of these concepts and ideas, right? So what that means is that environmental justice is leading to a new, different type of science in environmental health. This is very important. It's actually driving the development of a different type of risk science in environmental health. That's very important. Okay. So Initially then, when the environmental justice principles were first announced, it was basically a cause or policy without science. Because the scientists absolutely had no idea how to deal with the environmental justice issue. But as I said before, since for the past 20 or 30 years, it's actually played a major role in the development of epidemiological and environmental health science, especially what we call the community-based participatory research. Almost a lot of these requests for proposals from NIH insist on getting the communities to participate. This is a direct outcome of the environmental justice movement. It's changing the way scientists do their thing, which I think is very, very important. Okay, so let's look at how people have been doing this and studying environmental justice. Okay, so what they do is they do this. Here is their, I don't know if you can see it, maybe. So here's their factory, dump site, incinerator. So you draw a circle around it, 1 mile. I was at a big meeting with EPA where they were trying to decide whether to make it 2 miles instead of 1 mile radius in calculating effects or people that are exposed or are that at risk. And so you draw your 1 mile radius. And then the presumption is that if you live within this 1 mile radius, you're automatically at risk and you're being exposed. This here again, we're talking, it can just be hazards rather than anything else. So just a dump site, a hazardous site. It assumes if you live within a 1 mile radius, or whatever radius you may choose, then you're at risk or you're being exposed. Is that correct? There are many factors that determine whether you'll ever get in contact with whatever contaminant is in the dump site. So that's the first thing, is this idea that co-location translates or means exposure. It doesn't. Right, very important to remember that. So you take it, draw your mouth in, and then you do some type of transformation or some type of apportionment, and then you end up with some estimate of exposure. A lot of the papers on environmental justice you see, in fact, have been done that way. And then this is a classic figure from the Michigan group where they show that in general, you have more hazardous waste sites and industries in areas where you have the minorities, African Americans, than areas where the whites live. It's a classic example. And how did they do that? They base the whole diagram on the co-clustering of hazards and people. Again, if you live near people who lived within this 1 mile radius, you are classified as exposed. And so again, you need to, that's something important thing. And so let's do a quick critique then of a lot of the studies you see on environmental justice. Most of them are ecological in nature. That's a fact. Few of them actually have individual level exposures. So we're generalizing to a large extent. You haven't really looked at any single individual to see, indeed, to do a cause-effect assessment. Most of them actually fail to control for confounders, and you can actually assume most of them actually suffer from what they call ecological fallacy, which means if you have enough confounders or variables, you are bound to find some association, right? Again, this is something probably what is happening. Most of them use the school location as a surrogate for exposure. We know that is probably not quite true. And then few of them actually take the time dimension. The time of exposure is very important. See, depends on how long you live there, whether you were exposed when you are young and so on. These will affect the health, ultimate health outcome. And these, most of these studies in support of environmental justice program have not taken the time dimension into account. So, what can you read? What that thing says? Okay, well, basically, look, that's almost like the state we are in now. We're trying to figure out the health effects from all the noise, right? That's exactly what you're trying to do with the, and then, and as I said, the method we are using hasn't been giving us a very clear perspective. It's not, I have a clear perspective on exactly the cause-effect relationship between the exposure to contaminants in your environment or in a community and the health of the people in the community. So this is what we try to do. So we can approach, try to get a better picture by doing what they call robust science. And so that means now we can assess characterize the contaminant in the environment, in the neighborhood. We need to characterize the contaminants in the neighborhood. Then we need to do an exposure assessment, how much of the contaminant actually gets to people. It's not just what is in there. If people are not being exposed to what is in there, then it's, again, you cannot be complaining or talking about the health effects. So we need to actually assess properly who is being exposed and what the exposure dose is in the community. And then we need to assess the health effects that can be attributed directly to the contaminants in the environment. And from with the information, then we begin to look at potentially greater exposure, who is exposed more than who is being exposed at a higher rate than the other group or segment of the population. And then we begin to talk about susceptibility. Are women more susceptible to a particular contaminant in the community than men, for instance? Do we have any genetic effects and so on? So again, we need to do all that. So we'll be able to quantify the risk and be able to actually tell or establish a causal relationship between exposures in the community and the health effects. Well, this is what environmental health people do. We were comfortable just working on this arm, one arm of this metrics, right? But now people like Bullard will come along and say, yeah, but you're not taking all the factors into account. I need to consider the neighborhood resources, the community stressors, structural factors, so we can estimate the community stress that can affect ultimately the health effects. This is a scientifically difficult proposition. Most of people in the sciences are not used to dealing with these social, cultural aspects, and now we have to find a way to link them into the exposures that people find. So again, this has not been very easy going, right? And the reason I'm saying it is when we talk about environmental justice, we are just beginning to understand the problem, and the science still needs to be developed. And so a pregnant woman then comes and asks you, "Sir, ma'am, is my fetus at risk? I live in this community with a lot of toxic dump sites. Some people will automatically jump on the conclusion, yes, because I read in the environmental justice literature, if you live near a dump site, you're being exposed, your children are, the fetus is at risk. Is it really true? Can we justify that? Do we have the scientific justification for making that statement? Well, let's look at the factors we need to take into account to come out with a reasonable assessment of what the actual risks are, whether the fetus is at risk. So you have to worry about the outdoor environment. The pregnant woman is exposed to all this outdoor environment traffic, in addition to industrial sites, gasoline pumps. Is exposed to indoor air pollution, different types. It also has its individual factors, the genes and so on, educational characteristics, whether they smoke, eating habits, and then how much time they spend inside and outside. Again, it's not an easy solution. And this exactly is why people in risk assessment are at odds with the community members. This is why they don't, I'm sure you heard about, sometimes they don't believe scientists because they want the answer, and the answer is, if I live near that, it must be affecting me. It may be possible, but again, for scientists, you want to make sure that the science is right and you're actually making the scientifically credible recommendation. And so, again, at this point, that's where we do have this disagreement between communities sometimes and the scientists. We talk about environmental racism. That's another aspect of environmental justice. Dan has already explained it. So, can we factor racism into a risk assessment paradigm to establish a causal relationship between disease and exposure, right? Well, I guess you have a model for it. People have actually come out with a model. So here's the race. The race can affect your biological system, perhaps. You have your culture, socioeconomic conditions, racial, can experience racial discrimination, sociopolitical differences. And then these all feed into health practices, psychological stress, environmental stress, and so on, ultimately leading to biological processes that determine health. Again, it is possible, but it's going to be very, very difficult to determine. Again, we're talking about establishing scientifically credible causal relationship. You can do your correlation, but I'm talking about scientifically proving it. Can we prove it scientifically? Okay, so what have these environmental justice studies accomplished? A lot, okay? First of all, they have identified the hazardous agents and then about how people are exposed and have therefore been of great value in self-protection, because now it sensitized a lot of people. A lot of people provided information to a lot of people. So now they can use it to actually try to protect themselves. They have contributed to pollution prevention and remediation. And these are normally issues that are very important to communities that are facing environmental injustice. So in a sense, they've done very well. Provided information about the toxic material coming from factories, and therefore it's enabled some people to actually lobby for action and so on. They've also helped to locate the sources of pollution. They've helped to identify the unsafe environments. They've identified the racial and economic characteristics of communities that may be exposed to environmental hazards, and therefore they provided some basic principles of some basic patterns. These are just patterns of environmental justice. They provided patterns of environmental justice. And more importantly, these studies have provided the tools that low-income family communities have used to galvanize, organize, educate the general public, and then petition the government for action, and sometimes I've even taken legal action. So even though the science is not there or adequate, the study that have been done have been put into very good use. But to go to the next step then and provide a scientific proof, then that's where I see a lot of work and a lot of development in the science of environmental justice. Okay, let me skip it and then try to finish up with the environmental justice at the global or international level. And then this has become an issue internationally, globally. And then I want to focus on the driver of environmental injustice in the developing countries. What are the critical drivers of environmental injustice in the developed country? There are three. One, debt. Most of these countries are broke, they're bankrupt. Two, structural adjustment plan, SAP. Third one is compounded interest rate. Banks don't forgive and they don't forget. That's the third factor. And then it provides a way to link sustainable development to environmental justice. See, that's, again, if you're thinking of a term paper, why don't you think of how does sustainable development, how does that relate to environmental justice? Yeah, and I think you do have some very, very strong relationships between these two issues. So, the debt, the bankrupting of developing countries was actually born in the U.S., unintentionally perhaps, but it started right here in the U.S. So in the late 1960s, what is happening right now happened in the 1960s. Exactly the same thing that is happening now was what happened in the 1960s. So the U.S. was running a big deficit. So instead of getting China, by then China couldn't buy the bonds, U.S. bonds like they're doing now. So they decided to print more money, right? An easy way out. Print more money. And so what happens? It depressed the value of the dollar internationally. The value of the dollar declined. And so the OPEC countries that had pegged the price of oil to the dollar were not happy with that, because now they are no longer getting as much money as they used to. And so they decided to raise the price of gasoline. We know that a big price spike in the mid-1970s. Lo and behold, they have these huge amounts of money which they couldn't spend. They didn't know what to do with the money, the OPEC countries. So what did they do? Why don't they simply put the money into the U.S. banks? And that's exactly what they did. And as they pumped money, oil money into the banks, okay, this is just the amount of money that they were getting, started from the 1970, and then it's the price of oil, barrel of oil went up quite sharply. He provided a lot of money to these guys. And so what did they, so the banks was obviously, this was going to cause a major financial problem. They have money they can't lend out to anybody. Too much money to lend out. And so what did they finally decide to do? Why don't we give the money or loan the money to the developing countries at low interest rate? That at the time was a very good idea. They needed the money to develop. Banks have money. And so they simply decided to loan the money. And that's why the loan, amount of money loan, well, actually went up very quickly. But unfortunately, we ended up with the dictator's dilemma. So even though the money was supposed to be used for development, most of that actually did nothing. Either they were put into wrong investments, wrong developments, or no developments at all. A lot, some of the loans were used to simply for military hardware to suppress the some of the uprising in the various countries. And as normally happens, at a certain point then, so again, because of that, look at the depth of the Latin American countries from 1970 to 1989. It's true of practically all developing countries. So by the mid-1970s, the U.S. decided to tighten monetary policies, raise interest rate. The oil price started to rise. And bingo, the debts become mature. Unfortunately, the money has not been invested in any meaningful enterprises. And so what happened then, these countries were stuck with a lot of money that they couldn't pay for. One thing that happened is that some of them invested in money in growing cash crop that could be sold for hard currency. But this also, they get the money to almost every country in the world to do the same thing. So now you have a glut of crops and nobody can buy, so the price, they were not fetching the price that they expected. And then, bingo, by 1982, things have come to a head and Mexico declared bankrupt. The first time any country in the world has declared bankrupt, all right? Well, if you're a commercial bank, what do? You can't just, a country can't just walk away. I mean, country can't walk. So somehow they had to find a way to collect the money. And that's when they got together with the IMF and the World Bank. Remember these two actors. Terrible, horrible actors, if you're from a third world country. Okay, so they got together and created what they call Structural Adjustment Plan, SAP. The goal is to make sure that no country walks away from its debt. So they restructure the debt so they keep collecting interest, not the principal. The Structural Adjustment Plan was designed to collect the debt, the interest rather than the principal. So they rescheduled the principal and kept collecting the interest. And so what happened then is, and then they insisted that if you want to get any money from any bank or country, developed country, you must have to implement this so-called Structural Adjustment Plan. And what does it say? This is just what you call a poison pill. It's designed to kill the economy of the country dead, almost. It says that you have to spend less on health. You have to develop your national currency. You have to cut back on food subsidy. You have to cut back jobs and wages for workers. You have to encourage privatization. You have to take over small subsidies from small farmers and turn them into big farms. So basically mess up the whole economy of the country. And what happens then is that now most countries are bankrupt, either through the borrowing or through the IMF-sanctioned Structural Adjustment Plan. And so take an example, what this thing can do. In 1970, the poor countries owed $25 billion. By 2002, they have paid $523 billion on the $25 billion they owed. That's what they've already paid, but they still owe by then $550 billion more dollars. They borrowed $25 billion, have already paid $523 billion. They are still owing that amount of money. I'm not making this up. This actually is a fact. And so Obasanjo, I don't like the guy, but anyway, he used to be the president of Nigeria. He made this observation about debt in his country. He said that they borrowed, in 1985 or 86, they borrowed only $5 billion. By 2008, I think, they had already paid $16 billion, and yet they were still owing $28 billion to the World Bank, to the commercial banks, and the various foreign governments. So he says, if you ask me what is the worst thing in the whole world, I would say is this compound interest. Because when they reschedule your debt, they are compounding the interest. So you will never pay off what you owe. It's designed so that there's no way you can actually pay off what you owe. And so if you then look at what countries are spending on social services, very little. So now if you look at Benin, they're borrowing, foreign borrowing $54. They are spending $20 in foreign debt service, $18 for just the basic social services. Cameroon only spending 45 cents, paying more than what they get in loans and income to meet their debt obligation. What that then means is that right now, these countries are basically bankrupt because of the heavy loan, and therefore it makes it difficult then to meet or to develop sustainable anything, right? So how does influence of debt on environmental justice on sustainable development then? First of all, it's overuses the soil, so these countries can grow cash crops, and therefore forcing small farmers. If small farmers are going off the ground, they can't be developing sustainably. Produces crops from small areas, therefore they use fertilizers. The use of fertilizer in agriculture is not a sustainable agricultural practice, but this is what is encouraged under the structural adjustment plan. They allow overfishing, so they can generate income from their natural water resources. This is not sustainable development. They allow multinational companies to do logging and so on, destroying lifestyle. This is not sustainable development. And then they chop forests to make room for beef cattle that can then be sold for cash crop. This is not sustainable development. So again, I see environmental justice, sustainable development, and debt being strongly linked in the third world countries. So when you are thinking of developing sustainable programs for these developing countries, first thing you should think about is debt, and how will that affect the sustainable development you're talking about, and how will that affect the environment in these countries. So people think of debt then as a massive plundering, and it is indeed a massive plundering of the resources of the third world countries that has left huge legacies of environmental pollution. It is the best instrument that people are using, the North is using to control the South. It's actually better than colonialism because you own the country. A debtor has no choice, right? You own the country because they owe you. Well, instead, you are using the people actually to pay for their own suppression, because with this SAP forces these people to pay for their own oppression. So again, it's one of these cynical ways that what they call the neocolonialism is the idea now. You simply bankrupt a country and they will forever be indebted to you, and you control. It means that you can determine what they sell their product, what kind of crops they produce, and so on, especially if they sign on to the structural adjustment plan. So I'm sure you've heard about this guy, Strauss-Kahn, right? He's been in the news a lot. And so, this is a guy speaking to his lawyer in Manhattan. And so he's already messed up the African countries in a big way as the chairman of the IMF. He controls, he practices this SAP. And now he's also trying to mess up. Or he tried it, unfortunately. I don't think it worked very well. Okay. I covered a lot of stuff. I hope somehow something resonated with you. But again, I've taking a little bit different tact. I can come here and promote environmental justice, but we need to talk about the limitations, the restrictions, and where we need to go from here. So I'm a strong supporter of environmental justice. I still think that there's a lot that scientists can do to put environmental justice in a very strong scientific footing. Right now, we don't have that yet. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Yes.
We have plenty of time today to do each part well. And this is too important not to take people's questions thoroughly. The Brazilian case study will end wherever they are at 20 of 1, so you're on time for lunch, and then start again at 2 to make sure you have time to finish and take questions. So the Mexican case study, which we are looking forward to also, start at 2:30, and we have a book for that. And then we got someone with a real theory of how the global world should respond to these kinds of issues that were so thoroughly presented by both our speakers. So,
okay.
When you go out for your coffee break, don't come back and well, I come get you. But we'll do each part well as we move on. Thank you for letting me know.
Thank you, John. So I see there are already hands.
It's a good concept.
Can you repeat the question?
So the question is debt swap. So there's a program now that allows private organizations can buy the debt at a low discounted rate. And then the country is given the option, I think, to a large extent, to devote some part of the country, some parts of the country. So it's a debt swap. They forgive you part of your debt. For that, you had to devote some part of the country for conservation purposes. And the question is, that started in Costa Rica. That's when it started. It's a good concept, but there are issues. Brazil doesn't like it. Because what that means is they can come and tell you forever and ever you should not harvest any forests in such and such a place, or trees in such and such forests. So it simply almost takes over the management, resource management for the country. I think the people should decide what they do with their resources or how they manage their resources. So that's one thing. Another problem that has come up is that even when they agree, but after a while they may change their minds. That's again has happened. So it's a good concept, but it hasn't been properly implemented yet. Right, that was another question. Okay.
Facilities aiming to locate themselves where there's a poor area, how much more, less, or equally significant is the scenario of a facility being built and then it depresses the value of the area and it draws in poor communities? And does it matter which case in combating the problem?
is very, very important. And the first hearing I went to as an expert witness was in Flint, Michigan. And the company hired another scientist to make exactly that point, that in fact, the factory was there before people moved in. And therefore, it cannot claim environmental injustice because you had the option to live anywhere else. You chose to live near that factory. Therefore, it's no longer is your fault. So again, this is a common argument. You are correct that industries have used to simply blunt or counter any arguments about environmental justice. That's correct. That's an important, is certainly an important issue for debate.
But
okay.
The reason people move to those places
right.
is because the houses are cheap, which
right.
means that if you don't focus on the factory
right.
reducing the risk, so they represent a hazard, as you said, but they can
right.
put in technology to reduce exposure
right.
so that those who are not able to afford expensive homes
right.
can buy homes there and still not be at risk. I mean, I don't know how this case you talked about was resolved, but that would be a counter argument to the idea that just because real estate is cheap,
right.
the people there deserve to be polluted.
Okay, if you look at the principle of environmental justice, you're entitled to this thing. It doesn't mean that you can move in there, right? It simply says that most cases, most of the environmental justice programs have dealt with factories moving in. There are already some existing factories, and they want to increase the number or something. Usually that's where they've had their most success. It's very difficult to go and shut down a factory because of environmental injustice. It's very more difficult. See, so the question I'm saying is, can you claim environmental injustice when you move to an area with an exact where you know the pollution is load is very high? You have a lot of these industries. It's very difficult. Okay. Yeah.
So it was a brilliant presentation.
Okay.
I'm from India.
Okay.
I resonated with the sentence that we pay for our own oppression.
Right.
Our country is going through SAP.
Okay. Oh wow.
Our forest. Natural resources, rivers, agriculture,
right.
food,
right.
everything is being tuned to World Bank's music.
Right. IMF and World Bank.
IMF and World Bank.
Right.
Everything is being tuned towards that,
right.
including our media.
Right. Agree.
Including our media.
Right.
I have no question per se. My request to you being in here,
right.
what kind of an influence or what role you play in, I won't use the word called humanizing the debt.
Right.
What kind of a confrontation, what can we make to make this debt? Because this is a cycle, we can never get out of this. And
right.
I think the statement of the president of, this is what is exactly.
Right.
What do we do with this?
Quickly then. There are all sorts of programs now to forgive some of these indebted nations, they adapt. But it's not really true. I know there was a time that was how they claimed, what they were talking about is, for example, they pay the money into an account. So instead of the money then going to their developing countries or anything, they then use the money to pay the interest that is owed on the debt. This is what was proposed and promoted by the World Bank and IMF. But now I think the group of seven or eight have become serious that are actually forgiving the debt, but they haven't done anything. See, they keep talking every time they say debt forgiveness, but if you really get down to it, most cases the bank will apply the pressure.
Yep.
And therefore, after talking and the news conference, they all go home and they forget about it. The next year they repeat the sentence. So as far as I know, it's still a mess. It's still a problem. These countries are still as indebted as ever. and then more countries are being roped into this system that basically almost perpetrates their not being able to develop their countries, so unfortunately. There's not much more you can do. I wish India can look at the history behind SAP before they make up their minds. I like what Greenland did. Said, to hell with you, we won't pay you, right? Do you remember? That's what they said. Well, did anybody hear they buried Greenland recently? Well, if anything, the economy is actually doing better than that of the U.S. So I don't know why these developing countries simply get up and say, sorry, we can't pay you, right? If they have the resources, they can actually generate income from their resources instead of them giving the money to the bank, they use it to develop themselves. If you have something to sell and there's a global market for it, you sell it. So the question then is, why don't you use the money rather than give it away? Unfortunately, they depend on these so-called foreign expats. Okay. Okay, go ahead.
It's a continuation of Jeet's comment on this. It's true that it's a reality in India. Of course, we are, as of March of 2011, we had this loan of $311 billion.
Okay.
So per head, we are owing $311 per year. But I think, you know, it's the loans that is, which is always coming in the name of aid,
right?
But it's actually loan. They never say it's loan. It's all aid.
That's right.
And even cyclone aids is sent for cyclone victims are also loans. They have to pay dearly with the interest. But all these loans from World Bank, IMF, ADB, and many various others, in addition to the, you know, the so-called economic hitmen, John Parkins has already mentioned that.
Right.
All this is possible because the governments of the South believe in the type of development, the style of development that World Bank and IMF are feeding.
Right.
They believe that, you know, unless we buy these, you know, gas-guzzling cars and air conditioning machines and so on and so forth,
right,
we are not developed.
Right.
Although there are, you know, some examples that we can do and happily live without those things as well.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So whether it's pesticides or air conditioning, this kind of, you know, the belief and this reference to development,
right,
what I call developmentality,
right,
is the main bedrock necessity which makes this kind of loans possible. So I believe that, you know, the kind of grassroots movements with civic democracy,
right,
which actually makes this kind of viable alternative,
right,
lifestyle and living standards,
right,
qualitative development rather than quantitative growth in industrial development. That
right.
would be the only way, otherwise we can never get rid of these ones. Like you mentioned that, you know, in order to repay the loans, they give more loans.
Right, they're using the loan to pay off the interest.
Yes. And
so I compound everything
yes.
else. Right, yeah. Well, again, that's, you're quite true. And what I want to should add to that is, why do you want to give, if you have $350 billion, why do you want to give it to a foreign bank, like in India? Or else, why now do you want to basically mortgage
yeah.
your economy? Because after that, they have control in terms, they have to go through this SAP program, you have to sign on to reduce employment, all these things that they insist you do. See? We are basically.
And most of the money goes for nuclear programs and.
Right. And a little of that goes to actually to the people who are actually developing or producing something that can create or alleviate poverty or create jobs. Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah, I want to thank you. Your linkage of the global community and individual levels is extremely important.
and making the case for building a science that integrates risk assessment with environmental justice concerns. I was wondering about one challenge facing the science of risk assessment and environmental justice at the public health level, tracing the exposure levels to these health outcomes. Do you see a role for qualitative research that looks at people's sort of lived experiences near a waste dump or the effects on their sense of depression and helplessness? Because often those kinds of outcomes aren't tapped by the model that takes parts per million and links it to cancer rates or something like that. So there's a whole kind of psychological residue and cultural residue that happens through this sense of marginalization that might not be picked up by those quantitative measures.
Remember what I said, that the environmental justice movement is actually impacting the risk science. In fact, that's exactly the kind of thing that we need to do more of. We're on this right side of risk assessment. We need to include all these other factors. And as scientists, we don't always know how to do it. So we certainly encourage other disciplines that can work with the people in the environmental health field so that we can start looking at the whole picture, right? I was only giving you the perspective of an environmental health scientist. And I think definitely in terms of environmental justice science, we need additional tools, methods, models from these other fields. There's no doubt about that. The way to go. Anybody on the left side? Somebody on the left?
Left is satisfied.
Mostly students. The left, okay. They all voted for Obama then. That's okay.
But as our country is in this throes of the debt limit,
right.
I only read about economics in the popular press, so I don't really understand the implications of this. It's not like the U.S. is going to IMF or the World Bank to get the loans, but the consequences of not raising the debt limit on August 2nd, everybody's been hearing in the news, our interest category will change, and most of the people who are poor in this country are probably going to suffer the biggest consequences. So I know you've lived in this country for a long time and you care as much as you do about developing countries' debt interest. But I wonder if you can say something, if you follow the same news about the consequences of of raising the debt in the U.S. For these kinds of programs and you know, cutting all of the benefits of the things that are being proposed and what that would mean for environmental issues in the U.S.
Okay, what I can say is this. If the U.S. were a country in Africa with so much debt, the IMF will make them the first one to go through this SAP. If U.S. were in an African country or an Asian country. Unfortunately, the banks are all right here. So it's not likely that the U.S. will be asked to go through the structural adjustment plan. Any other place, if it were a developing country, they are ripe for it. IMF would have been clamoring and forcing them to go through the pill. The same thing with Greece, right? If Greece were just a few if they were in North Africa, by now they would have been forced into the structural adjustment plan. But again, this is, you're talking about European Economic Union, US, and therefore, this is it, what I call this differences or the whole things are done for whose benefit. The benefit, of course, if the U.S. were to go through that, then the banks will suffer, right? And so they wouldn't want that to happen. Whereas if it were in African countries, it doesn't matter. They will get their money somehow. So the reason for that, again, is because there are these difference, disparity, discrepancy in terms of how these things are done. Yeah.
Okay, we're 15 minutes behind, but we should, I know we are ready for the break now, so I want to thank again both of our speakers for those